tra tutti il mio cuore che hai acceso, chiudo dentro me la luce che hai incontrato per strada.
Good morning, Endeavor. And bonjour, Leo. Bienvenue à bord, Endeavor. Bon retour sur terre.
Thanks, Nick. Good to hear your voice. Glad to be on board Endeavor, coming back home. Glad to see everybody back on Earth. And thanks a lot for the music, and see you very soon.
This coming to us from the aft flight deck of the space shuttle Endeavour. Looking out the rear windows facing the cargo bay. Spacewalker Bob Binken on the right of your screen in the black t-shirt. Holding up what appears to be jelly beans. Continuing to demonstrate some of the effects of the microgravity of low Earth orbit. As they float around the flight deck, the aft flight deck of Endeavour, the spacecraft, the astronauts, and the jelly beans are traveling at about 5 miles a second, or about 17,500 miles an hour.
Léopold Deshartes, bonjour. Vous êtes avec Patrick Astaire avec.
Good morning. This is Patrick with France 3. Now you will be landing in a few hours. What have been the main points of your mission that lasted 48 days?
Bonjour. Il y a eu pas mal de moments forts.
Good morning. We've been very busy during this mission, but obviously. The most important for me and for the European Space Agency and for Europe was the Columbus module, the commissioning of the Columbus module. So the first 2 weeks, I think that were very busy, and the mission as a whole was very intense and very active. And also, you have had the vocation in which Louis Armstrong sent you a dedicated picture to you from the moon. So what do you think? You will have the same effect? Well, I think that it is very important for the young people, for the children to have objectives in their life. And this is what affected me when I was younger. And it made me make sure that I did certain things that were very important and follow through with them. And it is important for children to have dreams, objectives. And I hope that this mission itself, and myself as well, can contribute to these. And one last question before landing. Do you feel somehow a little bit scared?
No.
Everything is in order. We have inspected everything, and so there's nothing to be worried about. The only problem is the weather, and so hopefully we will be able to land tomorrow and otherwise the day after, but that's the only thing for our return. Thank you very much, and have a good landing. Thank you very much.
Bonsoir, Léopold, Nicolas Chateauneuf pour France 2.
Good evening, Léopold. This is Nicolas Chateauneuf. How was your mission on Columbus?
Bonsoir. La mission,
good evening. Well, the mission went very well. We commissioned the Columbus module during the first 2 weeks. Obviously, this was very amazing for us. It was a lot of work, and I think It was an extraordinary mission. It's the first one for Europe. And so we have some of the experiments that have already been conducted during this time on the new module. So after Mir, how was it for you to return back to space? I think the conditions were very different. Mir was the first experience, very different conditions with the Russian space station. And here, obviously, with the International Space Station, there was a lot of preparation. And during the years I spent in Houston were very enriching for me to prepare for this mission and be able to accomplish it properly. It was completely different from Mir. In the International Space Station, we have some objectives that are very different from what we had on Mir. And another question, isn't it difficult to work in weightlessness? It is quite difficult in the beginning, especially, but as in any other circumstances, human beings adapt, and so obviously it's not something you're used to, and it takes a lot of training and experience. Leopold, this is Jean-François. Can you hear me? I can hear you loud and clear. Welcome on board. Thank you, Leopold. So I am here with Valérie Pécresse, Stéphane Abrial, Jean-Jacques Dordain, and also with some students from Montpellier who are going to ask you some questions. The first question is, have you thought about looking at the stars from the shuttle, since you can see them through the cockpit? A little bit, but I must say that we haven't had that much time up to now, which is when we're heading back, because the cockpit has been very busy. And so I've been able to look outside, but not really the stars, but mostly the separation of the station. That was a wonderful view. I'm jealous. I would have loved to be with you. Now I'm going to give the microphone to Valérie Pécresse. Well, I can't wait to see you again. I remember when I met you, and have you been able to complete the experiments on Columbus? Good morning, Ms. Pécresse. It's nice to talk to you again as well. And yes, the experiments that we have been able to carry out on Columbus were experiments that are on the exterior of the station. And also, we started a biological experiment, and I will bring some of the samples back with me on Endeavour. With the Americans that are on Columbus with you, have they made any comments with respect to how everything went with the European module? Well, I think that the Americans are very happy to have seen the Columbus module arrive, because this will add additional experiments and additional means to conduct these experiments on the station, and they have used part of the module themselves. So for them, it's very important to see they have already installed actually some experiments of their own on Columbus. Leopold, now I'm going to allow Hervé Morin to talk. Good afternoon. Just out of curiosity, how do you feel when you come back? Do you feel that it's been too short, or do you feel anxious to return after you've been in weightlessness for so long? Well, it's a little bit of both, actually, for me. It was a very long mission, even though it wasn't as long as the ones that we've had in the past. But the mission was very intense. And so, on the other hand, I am very happy, of course, that Columbus was able to be commissioned, that the experiments have been underway, installed, and it has been very tiring, so I am happy to go back. Leopold, I'm going to allow a student from Montpellier who wants to ask you a question and talk about their projects.
Bonsoir, je suis Nance Makoski.
Good evening, I'm Nance Makoski. I'm a student, and we are working on this PICO satellite that we have designed to measure radiation. And we'd like to know, you astronauts, how do you protect yourselves from the radiation inside the station? Well, in the station, there are different devices that measure the intensity of the radiation. So each one of us has a dose measurer that allow us to let us know. So when we are close to Earth, we're closer with the environment, with a magnetic environment, but we are away from the Earth, then that creates a different problem. And so the structure of the station protects us, but not fully, so it's very important to work on this and to take this into consideration for the future.
Leopold,
have you seen any cosmic flashes during your flight? Yes, every once in a while we have seen more often, actually, when I was on Mir, but this time I have seen some. When you are on a station or on a shuttle, you do see that.
Leopold,
now the General Stéphane Abrial will ask you some questions. Good morning. Firstly, I would like to thank you for bringing into space such an important module that will encourage the French-American cooperation, as you know. And also, it's very passionate for all these children to hear this from you. So what is it that made you make this decision? And then secondly, as being a pilot in charge, how was this useful for you during this mission in particular? Good morning, General. I'm very happy to talk to you too. And as you know, I'm very happy to have been able to bring all these objects on board. They are here with me, and I hope that I will be able to bring them back in within some certain time. This has always been a dream, because I always worked in the Air Force, and I dreamt about this since I was a little boy. So this obviously has been the greatest objective accomplished in my career. For this kind of activity, there are a lot of pilots from the Air Force and from the American Air Force that obviously it takes a lot of training that needs to be adapted to the space station work that needs to be done. But obviously the professional background is needed in order to be able to work in space and to prepare yourself properly to fly into space. Thank you, Leopold. Now I'm going to let you talk to Jean-Jacques Dordain. Good evening, Leopold. I'm very happy to see you, firstly, because the last time it was just over the telephone that we were able to talk. But I would like to thank you for everything that you have done on Columbus. You have carried out a remarkable piece of work together with the rest of the crew. Obviously, you were not there by yourself. So the entire crew, American, Russian, or whatever it was, they all participated. So thank you very much. I think this was very important for Europe and for France. And I think that the Ministry of Defense, with a, there is the only regret that we have is that when they arrive on the station, unfortunately, you won't be there. That's why they were saying that hopefully you could go back in a week. I think, because obviously you would have been on Earth back for just 1 week when these objects go back to space. So, as I said the last time we spoke, I hope that you have provided this to the TV, that you are going to live there. And so as soon as you come to France, you can come to Toulouse and watch from the control center how it is attached properly to the space station, the TV that you brought over. Well, thank you very much for your words. And as you know, for me, it was a great motivation to be able to participate of this mission, and I'm very happy to have done that. And obviously, it will be one regret that it would have been great, but it would have been very lucky for us with all the problems we've had from programmation standpoint, programming with Columbus. So I think that I was very lucky, so I won't be complaining too much. I think that everything will go well when they receive the TV in good conditions and to transfer onto the station what the TV will bring. So I am happy to go back to Earth, and this will be a very nice memory for me.
Brent Jett, in piloting the shuttle training aircraft, headed down the 3-mile-long shuttle training or shuttle landing facility, the 3-mile-long, 300-foot-wide runway. And this view shows his takeoff on the 3-3 from the 3-3 end of the runway out to the northwest. He will be swinging around and heading back to the southeast to evaluate some cloud conditions out to the southeast. Later in the afternoon it gets, the thinner, the more scattered that those clouds appear to be, but real-time observations in the shuttle training aircraft will help greatly in the evaluations by the entry team before making the decision to bring Endeavour home on the first of two planned landing opportunities today.
Endeavour, Houston for the burn update.
Go ahead, Chip.
Well, Dom, unfortunately, the weather trend did not improve as we had hoped, so we are going to be waving off one orbit. As far as your FDF game plan here, we'd like you to go ahead and continue through the white pages down through 3-10, complete the vent door close, but stop short of the 302 Pro. And then you're cleared to go to page 6-2, and you can do the GPS incorporate and then wait on the IMU to IMU align. How copy?
Jim, we copy. copy the wave off for one rev. We're getting ready to do vent door closure in another 3 minutes. We'll not do the 302 probe, but we'll go to page 6-2 and do GPS incorporate and hold there.
That's a good read back, Dom. And just to let you know, right now the forecast for the second opportunity is scattered at 5,000, so we're looking for some improvement.
Thanks, Jim. And where's this layer at?
Dom, it's between 5 and 6,000 feet, and it's about 5 to 6/8 coverage right now.
Copy.
So at 4:30 p.m. Central, the team led by Richard Jones, the entry team, couldn't get comfortable with the weather. A little bit too unstable right around the Kennedy Space Center area and off to the southeast, that area moving toward the Cape. The forecast is expected to improve for the second opportunity, so the first opportunity is being bypassed. The crew's been given a go to stand down from the first landing opportunity. The second landing opportunity now the only one available for today, with deorbit burn 2 hours and 1 minute from now, with that deorbit burn occurring at 6:33 p.m. Central. Corresponding to a landing an hour and 6 minutes later at 7:39 p.m. Central Time, as the ground track moves a little bit further west, with Endeavour expected to fly high above the Yucatan Peninsula, crossing the Gulf of Mexico and the coastline of Florida around the Tampa-St. Petersburg area on the way to a landing at the Kennedy Space Center, again targeting runway 15, the northwest to southeast approach to the shuttle landing facility. Weather appears to be trending in favor of clearing up, but at the time that the decision needed to be made for the deorbit burn for the first opportunity, it just wasn't stable enough in the landing site area. Brent Jett, flying the shuttle training aircraft, had noted some moisture out to the southeast at around 25 miles away, and the trends showed that moving generally toward the landing site area. So the first opportunity has been waved off, and the team setting up for the second and final opportunity to the Kennedy Space Center today, with the clocks counting down to the deorbit burn just under 2 hours from now. That would correspond to a landing 3 hours, 5 minutes from now at about 8:39 this evening Eastern Time. The landing now officially becomes a night landing, and it would be the 16th night landing back at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida of the 68 landings in the shuttle program's history that have ended back at the launch site.
Endeavour Houston, we just took the latest weather brief, and we are ready for you to start fluid loading for the next opportunity.
Jim, we copy. We've heard that before.
Yeah, Dom, I wish I had better news, but we do see an improving trend in terms of the weather thinning, and the forecast, is undecided at this point. But we're going to continue watching. We got the STA out looking, and we'll give you updates.
Thanks, Jim. I sure appreciate it. We'll start drinking.
Cheers.
Astronaut Jim Dutton here in Mission Control, giving the crew the go for fluid loading 1 hour from the deorbit burn for the second and final landing opportunity tonight to the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. Continuing to look at the weather, there's still some clouds off to the south. Southeast. Those clouds are the ones of concern. The view from atop the vehicle assembly building looking off toward the southeast. This is camera pan, 360 pan view from atop the vehicle assembly building. The characterization is that while the clouds in the area of the shuttle landing facility are thinning, the cloud cover is still of concern, and so Brent Jett, flying the shuttle training aircraft, will head out to the southeast to characterize the cloud cover, the thickness of the clouds, and the movement, and feed that back to astronaut Kevin Ford here in Mission Control, who is providing the communications link for weather between Brent Jett and the flight control team here in Mission Control. This view looking west from the vehicle assembly building as the team continues to talk weather and the trends as we approach the time of the deorbit burn, approaching 14 minutes from now.
Dom, we'd like to get your thoughts on this. What we're looking at right now is a pretty good observation, but a possibility that we could see some clouds come in between 5,000 and 6,000 feet broken. And we're just weighing that versus bringing you back tomorrow during a daylight opportunity. Wanted to know your thoughts.
And Jim, we trained for the last couple months at night, both Fox and I feel really comfortable with that, and we're comfortable with that weather, if you guys are.
Copy that, Dom. Thanks for those words.
Okay, can we maneuver now?
Let me see if I can pull flight out of his huddle. Endeavour Houston, you can maneuver now.
Here it comes.
Had that call giving Dom Gorey permission to initiate the maneuver to the deorbit burn attitude just about 10 minutes now from the deorbit burn. The final caucus underway on the weather and the trends, especially the trends as reported by shuttle training aircraft pilot and astronaut Brent Jett, who is director of flight crew operations.
Endeavour Houston, good news. You are a go for the deorbit burn.
Endeavour copies. Go for the burn.
Approaching 8 minutes to the deorbit burn, Endeavour's attitude is now being changed to maneuver to the deorbit burn attitude. The crew has been given a go for the deorbit burn. That based on the last weather observation and forecast, the forecast from the Space Flight Meteorology Group amended just moments ago to indicate that the forecast was go observed and go forecast at the time of landing.
The first roll reversal has now been commanded, a right to left roll reversal. That coming with the vehicle traveling 13,000 miles per hour. The only remaining reaction control system jets that are active are the yaw jets. The rudder of the shuttle is still in the off position, commanded off. Until enough air pressure is sensed to make the rudder active, and that would be the point where the final RCS jets would be deactivated. Now just under 200,000 feet. Time to touchdown, 15 minutes, 30 seconds. The entry guidance officer shortly will be evaluating the global positioning system performance. That should come with the vehicle at an altitude of about 170,000 feet. Endeavour's altitude is currently 192,000 feet, traveling 10,800 miles per hour. Range to the landing site, 832 miles. Crossing the coastline of the Yucatan Peninsula, just about to make its final swing across the Gulf of Mexico, altitude 182,000 feet. Time to touchdown, 13 minutes, 35 seconds. Range, 635 miles. Confirmed acquisition of signal through the Merritt Island tracking station. The second roll reversal, a left to right roll reversal is underway. Endeavour is traveling 7,700 miles per hour, altitude approaching 170,000 feet. range to the landing site, 480 miles.
Endeavour Houston, Energy, Ground Track, and Nav are go. Your touchdown is 2,400 feet at 195 knots.
Endeavour copies all, thanks.
Endeavour, you can take GPS to pass only.
Jim, we're taking the GPS to the pass.
Good read back, and we got a little radicom.
At this point, the global positioning system is driving the primary avionics software. Time to touch down, 11 minutes. Altitude 150,000 feet. Time to touchdown 10 minutes, 35 seconds. Range 300 miles. Ten minutes to landing. Endeavour is 235 miles from home. Altitude 135,000 feet, traveling 4,200 miles per hour now. Coming up on the final roll reversal, this a right to left roll reversal. Endeavour now crossing the Florida coast just south of Tampa, St. Petersburg at an altitude of 121,000 feet. 170 miles from the landing site, traveling 3,400 miles per hour. Time to touchdown, 8 minutes, 35 seconds. The air data probes have both been deployed. Endeavour approaching the Kennedy Space Center from the southwest. Range 120 miles. Traveling 2,600 miles per hour.
Endeavour Houston, take air data.
Endeavour's taking air data.
The air data probe's doing their job, providing real-time air pressure and sensor data to the onboard computers. Altitude 90,000 feet, range to the landing site 85 miles, traveling 2,000 miles per hour. The rudder on the tail of the orbiter is now active. Altitude 78,000 feet. The vehicle is in the terminal area energy management guidance at this point. Guidance basically telling the onboard systems the proper maneuvers to make to intercept the heading alignment circle at the proper point and under the proper aerodynamic conditions.
Vector to the backup.
Endeavour copy, so transfer the state vector to backup.
Just a little more than 5 minutes to touchdown, traveling 1,000 miles per hour at an altitude of 70,000 feet now.
Endeavour Houston, you're on energy approaching the hack. No changes to winds or weather. Nominal chute deploy.
Endeavour copies. Nominal chute deploy.
First views of Endeavour, traveling 700 miles per hour at an altitude of 52,000 feet. Commander Dom Gorey flying Endeavour. Altitude 40,000 feet. Traveling just under 600 miles per hour. From this altitude, this is an operational altitude for a commercial airliner. Endeavour will be on the runway in about 3 minutes. Signaling the arrival of Endeavour into the landing area, just under 3 minutes to landing. This view through the pilot point of view camera. The heads-up display, altitude 29,000 feet. Pilot grip.
On at the 180.
Copy, on at the 180.
Pilot Greg Johnson taking his turn flying Endeavour around the heading alignment circle. He'll shortly hand that back, flying back to Commander Dom Gorey. And Commander Dom Gorey has the stick again, flying Endeavour through the last couple of minutes of its mission.
Endeavour, on at the 90.
Endeavour, on at the 90. Thanks, Jim.
Altitude 18,000 feet, time to touch down just under 2 minutes. Endeavour is still traveling 425 miles per hour, approaching the Kennedy Space Center from the northwest.
Houston Endeavour, field in sight.
Copy, field in sight, Endeavour.
Altitude 13,000 feet. Commander Dom Gorey notifying Mission Control. He sees the runway. Altitude 8,000 feet. Six thousand feet, 5,000 feet. Pre-flare maneuver coming up shortly, approaching 3,000 feet. Two miles from the runway. Gear is down and locked. Main gear touchdown. And nose gear touchdown. Space Shuttle Endeavour is rolling out on runway 15 at the Kennedy Space Center, completing 250 orbits of the Earth while traveling 6,578,000 miles. This landing marks the 16th night landing at the Kennedy Space Center and 22nd in the history of the shuttle program. Tonight's landing is the 68th at KSC. Endeavour spent almost 12 docked days to the International Space Station, a record, leaving the station larger and more capable than it was before. European Space Agency astronaut Leopold Ahearts, returning home after 48 days in space, 44 of those aboard the International Space Station.
Welcome home, Endeavour. Au revoir, Takao. Bienvenue, Leo. Congrats to the entire crew, to JAXA and to CSA on a very successful mission delivering the JLP and Dexter to their new home aboard ISS.
Thanks, Jim. It was a super rewarding mission, exciting from the start to the ending, and we just thank you for all your help. Looking forward to seeing you here soon.
Likewise, Dom, and we have no immediate post-landing deltas for you. We'll meet you on page 5-3 in the entry checklist.
Endeavour home after 16 days in space. The auxiliary power unit venting that you see on either side of the tail, that is normal. It is certainly more visible at nighttime.
Guidance in attitude, guidance in a good config.
Copy. Standing by, prop, are you in a good config? Still waiting on the card action's fine.
Okay, copy that. GNC, how about you?
Same for us.
Copy. Fido, you good?
Fido's good.
The targets on board are good. This is our second opportunity's targets.
Burn, no trim required.
Copy, good burn.
Endeavor Houston, good burn, no trim required.
Endeavor copies. Thanks, Jim.
On the KSC weather aircraft loop, and what the weather forecaster is talking about, the cloud coverage is going to be about the same, but I guess the chances of having cloud coverage on 1.5 is going to be slightly less compared to 1.3. Based on that, I think I do like your recommendation of 1.5. We'll look at the one-hour balloon results, but 1.5 seems to be the landing site that we want to stick with.
Copy flight, and also concur on looking at the one-hour balloon results.
Okay, copy.
Go ahead, Jim.
Tom, we are going to have an RF blackout for about 8 minutes, starting at MET 1744. We expect to start picking you back up again at MET 1752, but there will be some radicom there for a period until we get on the upper antenna. Minutes of hand down.
Flight Fido.
Go Fido.
Dual source tracking shows us on energy on ground track.
Copy that.
Flight guidance nav is go. Take GPS to pass.
Copy that.
Endeavor Houston, energy, ground track, and nav are go. Your touchdown is 2,400 feet at 195 knots.
Endeavor copies all.
Flight deck, take air data to the GNC.
And an F.
Take air data.
Endeavor Houston, take air data.
Endeavor's taking air data.
Okay, let's see, guidance. You're going to be asking for that state vector transfer?
Yeah, flight guidance, I'd like a state vector transfer to the backup, please.
Okay.
Endeavor Houston, transfer the state vector to the backup.
Endeavor copies, we'll transfer the state vector set. Backup.
Endeavor Houston, you're on energy approaching the hack. No changes to winds or weather. Nominal shoot deploy.
Endeavor copies, nominal shoot deploy.
Okay, folks, we're getting ready to watch the crew roll onto the hack. Flight there, CSS all axes, CDR's flight.
Copy all.
PLT's flight.
On at the 180.
Endeavor, on at the 180. Endeavor, on at the 90.
Endeavor's on at the 90. Thanks, Jim. Houston Endeavor, field in sight.
Copy, field in sight, Endeavor.
For the room, on glide slope, on central line.
Copy, on and on.
Nominal approaching land.
Copy, nominal.
Gear standard locked.
Copy gear.
Main gear touchdown. Nose gear touchdown.
Ground speed enabled. Immediate post landing deltas max.
No deltas.
Eagle.
No deltas.
Ecom.
None.
GNC.
None.
Prop.
None.
DPS.
None.
Inco.
None.
Booster.
None.
We'll meet them on 5-3. And let's see, Inco, we're going to need UHF.
Crew now is walking off the crew transport vehicle and will be performing their walk around. Center Director Bill Parsons is greeting the crew along with officials from NASA headquarters. Now walking over toward Endeavour. Commander Don Gwory now talking with Administrator Michael Griffin and Deputy Administrator Shanna Dale. Chairman of the Mission Management Team, Leroy Kame, with Bob Bankin. Here's mission specialist Rick Lenahan. Right now, the expectation is that Endeavour will be towed to the hangar at the Orbiter Processing Facility between 12:30 and 1 o'clock. Lenahan and Dom Gorey. Weather on the runways is very acceptable for the remainder of the time that Endeavour will be out there. No rain in the forecast. Temperature in the mid-60s. And just light northeasterly winds. Now boarding the crew transport vehicle for the 20-minute ride back to the astronaut quarters. And there they go, after 16 days in space, 250 orbits of the Earth.
Welcome to this post-landing news conference for Space Shuttle Endeavour's STS-123 mission to the International Space Station. We have five gentlemen here joining us this evening here at NASA's Kennedy Space Center to talk about Endeavour's flight. First off, we have NASA Administrator Michael Griffin. Next, we have the NASA Associate Administrator for Space Operations, Bill Gerstenmaier. To his left is the Vice President of the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, Kaoru Mamiya. Next, we have the chair of the STS-123 Mission Management Team, Leroy Kane. And finally, we have Space Shuttle Launch Director, Mike Leinbach.
Good evening.
We'll start with questions, and then with comments, and then we'll open it up for questions.
Well, let's keep comments short. I'll start out. We're just real pleased to be here. I was telling the commander tonight, Dom Gorey, Mission Commander, that he had really flown two missions in one for us, delivering the first part of the Kibo Laboratory and the Canadian Dexter arm, orchestrating the whole thing superbly. I can't imagine that the mission could have gone any better, and they made it look easy. We're grateful to the crew, and we're grateful to all the people behind the crew who made this happen, our Canadian partners, our Japanese partners, our industrial partners here in this country. It all just came together like clockwork. It is an enormous point of pride for us to get the first part of the Japanese Kibo module up after these many years certainly going back to when I was working on the space station program 15 years ago and more. We wanted to have this happen, and this is the mission where it finally got accomplished, and of course the next mission is even bigger. So stay tuned.
Thanks, Mike. Again, it's my privilege to be here and pleasure to be here. What a great day this is. We were out waiting for the landing of Endeavour, and we got to see the ATV fly overhead. And then about 4 minutes later, we got to see the space station fly overhead, and then we got to see the shuttle land. And I can't think of a better day or the better ending of a day than to see those three wonderful pieces of hardware and to see all the hard work of all the folks that have spent many hours, much of their life, putting that hardware together, getting it ready to go fly. So it was just a great experience today and a real tribute to the team that's put all this work together. We took a look at Endeavour on the runway. The vehicle looks really good. Things look really great. The crew was in great shape. They did a great job, as Mike said. I can't imagine how much work they really got accomplished. It worked out just really well. So, again, great tribute to the team, and it's great to be here. Thank you.
Well, I'm lucky to witness the landing, safe landing of the shuttle. And welcome all the crews, including Mr. Doi, a Japanese crew, to the station. And we are quite honored that Mr. Doi contributed to the construction of the space station. And it's the first step for our Kibo construction. And we hope the next time the main module will be added to the station. And we thanks for NASA, ESA, Canada, and Russia for all partners and those who contributed to the success of today's mission. Thank you.
Okay, well, good evening. It's great to be here, as it always is, after a safe and successful landing. I think I will keep my comments brief as well. I spoke at length in the briefing we did on Monday afternoon about how extraordinary this mission was from a docked mission standpoint. It's going to be very difficult to top it. I think we raised the bar. And what was remaining was a safe and successful landing of Endeavour. So we couldn't be more pleased about how the mission has gone, and it's just great to be here. And the crew looks good, and they're very happy, obviously, as we all are after such a successful mission. So we'll turn Endeavour over to the shuttle processing team and let Mike and the team go to work on her, and we'll set our sights on the next mission. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Leroy. Well, the vehicle really looks great out there on the runway, and I got to talk to several of the people that work on Endeavour for a living, and they're just really proud to have Endeavour home safely. And I got to talk to the crew, and the crew is just having a fantastic time reflecting on their mission and looking up at the vehicle that just landed. And so they were glad to be home, very proud of the work they did, and we're very proud of the work they did, too. So it's good to have Endeavour home. Processing on the next vehicle is going fine. And so on behalf of the Kennedy Space Center, good to have a great mission behind us. We're looking forward to the next one.
Okay, we'll open it up now to questions. And after I call on you, we get the microphone to you. Please state your name, news affiliation, and who you'd like to answer your question. And we'll start off, for simplistic sake, on this side. Bill.
Hi, it's Bill Harwood with CBS. I'll ask Mike, but it may be a better question for Garrett, I'm not sure. Here's some rumblings that 124 may slip 5 days or so a week, you know, because ET just got here. And I'm just wondering, for those of us that
go to JPL to watch the Phoenix landing, what the odds are that you guys might deconflict that for us. Thanks.
You can go watch the Phoenix landing. We're working on the exact date for the STS-124, but you can go watch the Phoenix landing.
Give you a better idea what kind of time frame we're talking about.
Well, not yet. Within a few days, but you know, you're deconflicted enough that we know you'll be deconflicted enough that you can manage it with a round trip ticket, because I'll tell you this: the landing day on Mars is fixed. It ain't moving.
Thank you very much.
All right. Peter. Peter King with CBS News. I guess this question is probably for Mike. The pictures of the flame coming out in front of the tail. the APU venting. I think Kyle Herring's line was pronounced or more pronounced because of the night. Can you explain a little bit what that's all about? Because a lot of people are going to see those pictures and wonder what and why.
Well,
it's there on every mission.
It happens every mission. It's the APU exhaust. And obviously, you can see it at night a whole lot better than during the day. In fact, it was so pronounced tonight that we could see it on final as Dom was approaching the end of the runway. And before he even got into the xenon lights, if you looked really, really closely, you could see it. Pronounced tonight, not quite sure why. Sometimes atmosphere has a little bit to do with it. But it does pulse as the APU injects the hydrazine over the gas generator bed. It's a pulsation kind of scheme. And so that pulsing is very natural. It happens every time. It just, you got to see it a lot better tonight.
I was going to say, I mean, I've talked to veterans who've covered this program a lot longer than I have, and I think they were even floored by how pronounced it was. I mean, this is nothing that alarmed you or shook you or anything like that.
No, it was no alarm. It was pretty fascinating to see that clearly tonight.
Back to Tark.
Thank you. This is Tarek Malik from Space.com and Space News, and my question is maybe for Dr. Griffin and Mr. Mamiya. This mission had a French astronaut coming home, a Canadian robot, and the first part of a Japanese module going up. And I was just curious what your insights are now that you've got all the partners on the station about, you know, the way forward in terms of international cooperation. Thank you.
Well, we said this was going to happen. We've been working toward this. It has happened. It took years to make it happen. I've said, Tarek, on quite a number of occasions that if you look around, there really isn't anymore a U.S. human spaceflight program or a Russian human spaceflight program. There is a world human spaceflight program centered around the building and then later the utilization of the International Space Station. And we hope when we get that under our belt that this partnership will return to the moon and later go on to Mars. But it's something that we're doing together and have been doing together for quite some time. You're just now seeing the fruits of that work, but the work's been going on. Mamiya-san?
Yeah. I agree with Dr. Griffin in the sense that we have constructed very strong ties among partners, and it's quite a precious experience, and we want to continue and expand these ties toward the future, even though nothing is committed yet. But direction will be the as Dr. Griffin told. So we will cooperate in every aspect of the program.
Okay, we'll stick on that side of the room. Anybody else? Okay, we'll come back to this side. Sorry. And we'll go in the front row.
Hi, I'm Maddie Hartke-Weber from Junior Scholastic News, and I have a question for Mr. Mamiya. When KIBO is completed, what do you hope to learn from conducting experiments in open space?
What kind of experiment?
Any types of experiments you'll be conducting in open space.
Yes, of course. Our KIBO module is special in the sense that we can conduct the experiment inside, but also outside of the module. So all sorts of experiment is possible. And the KIBO was constructed by Japanese, but it's open to international society, especially for partners. So partners can utilize our module inside, outside, both. So I hope a very effective experiment will be conducted on KIBO.
Thank you.
Okay, go to the second row, please.
This is Hiroshi Masumitsu from Yomiuri Shimbun. This mission was the first step for Japanese contribution. And it will continue. My question is about it. One for Dr. Griffin. What do you expect about Japanese contribution, especially including HDV? And one more for Mr. Mamiya. When will HTV fly? Thank you.
Well, obviously, the Japanese contribution to the International Space Station program is crucial. They have Japan has just furnished the first part of what is an incredibly sophisticated scientific laboratory. The reason for the space station is to conduct scientific research in space, and one of the four laboratories aboard is the Kibo laboratory, and arguably the most sophisticated laboratory. Second, we do need cargo resupply to the space station, and the HTV, when it flies, will be an important part of the logistics resupply plan to the space station. So Japan is contributing in a very major way.
Yeah. Anyhow, Kibo is a first step for our utilization of the space, and first step for all sorts of the human manned activities. And as far as the HTV is concerned, now we started the experiment on a clustered engine in Tashiro, and we want to complete by the summer next year.
Thank you for the answer.
Okay, any other questions on this side of the room? No? Okay, I'll go back to the other side if we could, and go back with a few new people. All right, we'll start off. Yeah, Bill, go ahead.
Okay. Two quick ones. One for Dr. Gerstenmaier. Is there any update at all on downstream flights with ET deliveries? And obviously Hubble is the flight a lot of people are looking at down the road. Is there anything you can say there? And for Dr. Griffin, is there, speaking of Phoenix, is there anything you can add to the Mars rover situation, Dr. Stern's departure? That seemed like a kind of an abrupt thing this week that went on, and I didn't know if there's anything, any light you'd care to shed on that. Thanks.
Well, I don't comment on personnel matters, and so, you know, Alan announced that he was leaving for his own reasons. I certainly didn't want him to leave or ask him to leave, and in fact, I asked him to reconsider and to stay. I didn't see that he needed to leave, but he wished to, and so he did, and I've accepted that. And we've announced that Ed Weiler, a former science mission director at AA, will return to headquarters from his position at center director of Goddard and run the science mission directorate, and it'll be just fine. Ed's very experienced with that, and we don't have any better people. So that will take care of itself. With regard to the Mars rover controversy, it basically is as reported, Bill. We didn't put any spin on that. A letter went out from headquarters or directing budget cuts in Mars Odyssey operations and Mars rover operations that basically would have crippled ongoing programs. That direction was not cleared with me ahead of time. Had it been, we wouldn't have had that controversy. It was not a good idea, and when it came to light, I reversed it. We go through budget exercises all the time at headquarters, as you know. If missions overrun or get extended in time, they need additional money to get supported, and we have to do less of something else in order to support what needs the money. So that happens all the time. It's very unusual to have a letter of direction go out to make cuts of the type that were described without it being fully vetted, and that happened in this case. And, of course, you know, my goal will be to see to it that that doesn't happen again. It was just plain and simply a mistake, and there's nothing else I can really say about it.
Yeah, and in terms of tank processing, the tanks we're getting now are essentially, you could think of them as clean build tanks, whereas before the tanks we had were, you know, tanks that had been built before the Katrina hurricane, and we were repairing and making modifications to those tanks. So we're gaining some experience in seeing how long it takes to put those tanks together, how to fabricate them, how to put them together. And NHST is a little unique in the fact that we need to have two tanks down here ready to go support that mission, the tank for the flight itself and then the tank for the contingency flight. So we're off evaluating now what that production schedule looks like. We really don't have a good handle on that schedule yet. Once we understand a little bit better where that fits, so we'll then announce where we think those flights are going, if they're going to move, and see where they are. But right now, we're still, it's really a little early to look at that and see and assess, but we understand that the work is a little bit different than we had before, and we're going to have a different production schedule. So things will slip probably a little bit for those tanks.
Todd Halverson of Florida Today for Gerst with kind of a follow. I'm wondering if you can give us a ballpark estimate, an idea of how the remainder of your station assembly missions are going to be spaced out between now and the end of 2010.
If you take a look at the budget manifest or the flight manifest that we have out there, that's pretty much the framework that we've got laid out. You know, we still haven't made an official decision yet on Atlantis, whether we're going to operate it or fly it two more times. You know, again, that's becoming pretty obvious to us that that's something we want to go do, and that's the way we're going to probably go put it together. We still got a little bit more work to do to make sure that that is absolutely the right thing to do, that there's not any hidden gotchas there. So we're going to add probably two more flights to Atlantis after the HST flight, and then we'll lay out the manifest. And it looks like we complete before the September 30th, 2010 date with a little bit of margin the way it's laid out now, and it looks fairly decent on paper, even if we kind of have some delays along the way of what we've seen before.
Thanks. And for Mike Griffin, I'm wondering if you could give us a preview of what you're going to tell Congress about the KSC transition with the workforce. I think you have a report due coming up.
We do. The actual reporting date would have been March 24th, except that Congress is in recess, and we thought it was a little bit tacky to hand them a report while they were in recess. So we've made arrangements with them to deliver it to the Congress shortly after they return. And no, I'm not going to go beyond my prior statements on the topic. I think they're entitled to the report first. It's the first of many. The legislation which requires the report requires us to deliver it every 6 months. It's a work in progress as we try to understand what happens to our workforce picture as we transition out of shuttle and into Orion and Ares. I don't mean to sound either cavalier about it or glib. I think all of you here know how hard I have worked to try to minimize the gap between shuttle retirement and the onset of new operations with a new system. But we will have, through budget for budgetary and many other reasons, we will have a gap of several years. We are ending the shuttle program, after all. We are bringing the shuttle program to a close in 2010. And it will have very difficult effects on the local workforce. So I'll let the report speak for itself when it comes out.
Okay, we'll come around down the middle.
My name is Hiro Watanabe from Japanese newspaper Sankei Shimbun. My question would be not directly related to today's landing, but I want to ask Administrator Griffin about Space Shuttle's retirement. It will happen in 2010, and the next generation space craft, Orion, will appear maybe 2014 or 2015. And this gap would be crucial for Japanese manned space activity. So I want to ask, is there any possibility to postpone the timing Space Shuttle's retirement? I mean, do you have an option to use Space Shuttle, continue using Space Shuttle after 2010?
No, I'm afraid not. We are retiring the shuttle in 2010. If we don't retire it in 2010, then we will not have the money to bring a new system online even by 2015. In the interim, we expect to purchase crew transportation services from our Russian partners, and we expect to meet our obligations to our international partners, including Japan, by that means.
My name is Hajime Tobe with the Kyodo News, a Japanese newswire. My question is for Dr. Griffin. Now that we get the first segment of Kibo attached, so we are concerned about the ISS operation after 2015. So what are you going to do with the ISS operation after 2015 and as the U.S. government? And when and how or in what process are you going to consider it? Or what do you think we should do with the ISS operation?
This is a question we get a lot. I would remind everyone that the United States makes its budgetary decisions on a with a five-year window, and so our current budget extends out only through 2013, and therefore does not contain any specific plans at this point for the International Space Station past. Actually, at this point, past 2015. Now, you know, I've said on a number of occasions that I will not be the administrator at that time. Today's president will not be president at that time. The next president will not be a president at that time that we would want to decide what to do with the space station. And there will be several U.S. Congresses which come and go between now and then. So the decision makers of that time, not this time, will be the ones to decide what to do with the station after the 2016 date. As a purely personal opinion, because I will not be in this job at that time, but as a purely personal opinion, I find it difficult to imagine that U.S. policymakers will want to stop operating a perfectly good space station. So if the space station is working in 2016 and beyond, my own expectation is that it will still be in operation. But again, you're talking about events 7, 8, 9 years in the future, and I don't feel qualified to comment on what will happen at that time.
Okay, we go down to the side there to Vic. Back along the corner.
Vic Ratner from ABC, probably for Mr. Gerstenmaier. The crew chose not to speak to microphones tonight, since you all saw them close up. I'd ask whichever one of you wants to venture an opinion how steady or unsteady you thought they were on their feet, and after 16 days in zero gravity, what were you expecting?
Well, I can tell you they were great, and they were really excited about what they have just done. I asked them what they thought of space station. And it's pretty much the kind of conversations you've heard from them on orbit. They were excited about how big it is, how really a magnificent a research facility it is. Just the size, the scope of what they've done was exciting. I asked them if they were tired, and they said they were not tired. It seemed like they were ready to go again. So, I mean, I can't imagine a crew coming back in better spirits than the crew that we saw on the runway today. I mean, were really happy. They were really relaxed. They had really gotten in the groove of operating on space station, and they just did a phenomenal job.
And actually, Vic, just to point something out, it actually was not the crew's decision not to speak. It was actually I'll take responsibility for this. We had a lighting issue on the tarmac and weren't able to light them, so they weren't able to do their they didn't choose not to. They just weren't able to provide comments. So we're gonna have to wait till tomorrow morning to tomorrow afternoon actually to hear from them. But it was not their decision. It was I'm gonna take on public affairs part. So. You have any other questions right now? All right, speaking of that, our next news conference is for STS-123 is the crew. We'll talk to them tomorrow, Thursday at 1:30 p.m. Eastern Time, here before they head back to NASA's Johnson Space Center in Houston. If you have any time for information about the STS-123 mission and its crew, you can go online at www.nasa.gov/shuttle, and thank you for joining us. Thank you.
Be tough, Bill.
Raumfähre Endeavour ist am Morgen sicher in Cape Canaveral gelandet, allerdings mit 1,5 Stunden Verspätung, weil das Wetter so schlecht war. Das Shuttle war mehr als 2 Wochen im All, so lange wie nie zuvor. Die Besatzung hatte an der ISS Teile eines Labors und einen Roboterarm installiert.
2 Wochen im All ist die US-Raumfähre Endeavour wieder zurück auf der Erde. Die 7 Astronauten an Bord landeten in der Nacht auf dem US-Weltraumbahnhof Cape Canaveral in Florida. Die US-Weltraumbehörde NASA sprach von einer exzellenten Mission im Weltall. Die Astronauten absolvierten 5 Außeneinsätze und dabei installierten sie Teile eines Weltraumlabors an der ISS und montierten eine in Kanada gebaute Roboterhand.
Sind die Astronauten der US-Raumfähre Endeavour wieder zurück auf der Erde. Aber es war eine Rückkehr mit Hindernissen. Wegen schlechten Wetters konnte die Crew erst nach einer 1,5-stündigen Ehrenrunde zu einer Landung auf dem Weltraumbahnhof Cape Canaveral ansetzen. Bei völliger Dunkelheit ein seltenes Manöver. Während ihrer Mission hatten die Astronauten Arbeiten an der internationalen Raumstation ISS durchgeführt. Sie installierten unter anderem Teile eines Labors und einen Roboterarm.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is our STS-123 post-landing press conference with the Endeavour flight crew. We'll be talking with the crew, answering questions. Commander Dom Gorey will have a few comments. And Leopold Aarts is also joining us by phone from the crew quarters. So we're going to begin first with some comments from Dom Gorey. Dom?
Thank you. Thank you for coming here this morning, and good morning to everybody watching NASA TV today. We've had one of the most remarkable missions I could have ever imagined. Coming home last night, put just a final storybook ending on just an awesome flight with the guys I got to fly with, and 5 EVAs, a staggering, ambitious flight that we set out for, and it turned out just wonderfully because of the guys sitting to my left. The weather last night wouldn't quite cooperate on the first opportunity, but I think it was destiny because we had trained for a night landing, and that's what we were going to do, by God. And that's what he was in control of, was the weather, and we were not. So we waited on that. It cleared up just great. And flying over Orlando last night was spectacular. The lights of the city were clear, and the runway was ready, as was KSC. Endeavour was in great shape, and it brought us home just superbly. Got to see our families last night. And everybody's feeling great. Leo is doing wonderfully at crew quarters. He's got a lot of medical tests that they run on those guys after a long duration stay, so he gets to stay there and enjoy that. But we have had a wonderful mission, and just a great, great crew. A lot of stories to tell. And with that, we'll just turn it over to Leo and get his comments, and then we'll take some questions if that works out okay.
All right, Leo, if you can hear us, if you could say a few words.
Very happy to be with this great crew 123 and also with 122 crew. That was a wonderful mission, but I think I still need a couple of days to be back to Earth for good. And I will be, of course, ready to answer your questions if you have some.
All right, thank you. We'll take questions now. Please give your name and affiliation when the microphone comes to you. Since we don't have interpreters, if you would ask your questions, please, in English, that would be appreciated. So we will start over here with any questions that we have. Todd?
Todd Halverson of Florida Today for Dom Gorey. I found it interesting last night that the entry flight director asked what your thoughts were about coming in on the second rev. Is that unusual to kind of ping a commander before reentry?
I've heard it before, and we were actually really pleased that they asked our opinion. The weather was clearing up rapidly. I think anytime you come back from a flight that's this long and this intense, the commander has got the best feel of how the crew is doing. If it's been a long day, that would surely be a factor in whether you want to come back for a night landing, because it is a quite a different landing than a day landing. I make an analogy like at the aircraft carrier, if you have a choice between a day and a night landing for complexity, the day one is much, much easier. It's maybe an order of magnitude more difficult at night with the lack of depth perception and those kinds of things. And if the crew's feeling great, then and the weather's looking good, the crew on board is the right one to ask that question to. The STA pilots had already been pulsed, and they were calling it go observation. And so I was really pleased, actually, that they had asked us that question. And I think that's the right thing to do. Worked out great. Yes, Todd?
Just a quick follow. They predicted that you might find a broken deck at 5,000, in between 4,000 and 5,500, I think. And I was wondering, it looked like you, in fact, found that deck. What were you able to see on the way in, and did you have a cloud deck?
As we were approaching Orlando from the south, I think we flew over Disney World, Tampa to Disney World, and then we had that Disney World approach, and we were in that left bank, and we could see the city clearly as we were approaching the heading alignment circle. As we approached the 180, so a beam the runway, we looked down and we could see a few clouds, and the STA pilots reported that off to the south, I think it was, that there was a pretty good deck, but we never passed through any clouds. From the thermal imagery I saw after the flight, it looked like we might have penetrated some, but I do not recall. I don't think we flew through any of them. We had a good, clear view of the runway from when it came into the pilot's or the commander's window at about the 90, and it was nice the rest of the way. So it was a good choice on the forecast and a good choice on time to re-enter.
Tarek?
Thank you, Ed. Tarek Malik with Space.com and Space News, and my question is for Box, Bob, or Mike. Your rookies know more after what has arguably been a marathon construction flight, and I guess, you know, now that you've got your feet back on the ground, you know, what is the freshest part in your mind right now, if it's something off time or construction, or I guess what is jumping out for you now?
Well, the thing that jumps out to me is the launch. After almost 10 years of training, there's no way that they could have burned that image or that event into my mind. I could have never imagined how it was going to be until we actually did it, and that's my greatest memory.
I think launch is a great memory for me as well. We were able to break out the launch tape, our ascent flight deck video about maybe it was flight day 10, something like that, and watch it and kind of relive that whole process, and we were all kind of in awe watching ourselves on camera, I guess, as we went through the ascent. For me also, the EVAs, I got to climb around on the space station quite a bit. I got to climb on the JLP after it was installed to put some covers on it for Takao. I got to climb on the Columbus module to install an experiment on the end of it. I got to climb to the top of the truss to open up some a target for a future mission. So I got to translate quite a bit around the space station, and just the views that I was able to see looking down into the shuttle, looking down on the Earth, was just remarkable for me. So that's the most memorable thing after the launch.
And I would say the same thing. Launch, the EVA is the first view out of the hatch. The first EVA was, you know, just incredible. And I've tried to burn some of those images into my mind because I know it'll seem like a dream here in a few days. And looking back, and the other thing is the enormity of the space station as we approached. It was incredible sight from, you know, 400 feet out, just how massive the thing was. And so that's the other image that I'll remember.
Additional questions? All right, Todd, another follow-up.
Todd Halverson of Florida Today for Rick Linehan. It seemed to me like you guys had a little more of a workout during your spacewalking assembly work with Dexter than you might have anticipated. I'm wondering if you can recall that for us. And also, what did that android really look like to you when you got done with it?
Well, Todd, if you've seen that movie Transformers, he looked like a giant transformer to me. He was all bundled up in the SLP, and then he started to unfold, and it was kind of like this giant arachnid with these arms and legs and booms sticking out everywhere, and he even had kind of a semblance of a head. And as for the trouble you alluded to on EVA 2 with getting him out of the SLP, I would have to say that it was the robots against the humans, and the humans prevailed.
All right. Tarek, and then we'll start over here.
Thank you very much. It's Tarek Malik from Space.com and Space News again for Takao. I guess now that you're back on Earth and the first part of Kibo is on the station, you know, what are you looking forward to? How do you feel knowing that the next part will fly in less than 2 months? Thanks.
Well, I'm just very satisfied with the current mission, and we did everything we could do in this mission. I'm very happy about that, and also I'm very happy to be a part of this crew. I think we couldn't do it better than this. Thanks.
All right, let's come right here.
Hajime Tobe with the Kyodo News. My question is for Mr. Doi. You revisited the space after nearly 10 years break, and how was the experience there? And what did you find in terms of human being a human going into space this time? I would like your answer in English as well, if you may.
Okay, I'll answer this question in English. And well, the space, the same. I enjoyed being in space in my first mission, and I enjoyed actually better this time because my body adjusted to zero gravity much faster this time, probably twice as fast as before. So I had an incredible kind of feeling about human ability, how we could adapt to space, and well, that's the reason why we are heading to space, and it's a way to go.
All right, a question here.
My question is, firstly, to Mr. Doi, what's your next step about space program?
Okay. Well, I have not decided yet what I should do next, but I'm already missing the space station. It was a great place to visit and a fun place to explore. And so I wish I could go back, hopefully, anytime, maybe tomorrow or soon. But as I said, we couldn't do a mission better than this. So. I'll see what I can do. Yes, I'm thinking about it.
All right, would you have a follow-up? Okay.
One more question to Commander Gori Dominic. We all know you love Japanese food, but you shared a very long time with Japanese astronaut or French astronaut or Russian astronaut in International Space Station, and have you found any cultural gap in the space among the crew, like way of thinking, way of communication, or way of life? Could you explain some episodes you found
As for differences between astronauts, I think what made this crew special was that there was no differences. I think we worked together as a crew of seven going up and seven coming down and 10 on the space station so well that the mission was a wonderful success. That's why it was a success, was when we started this training flow. That was our philosophy. If you've ever seen our crew picture, our hands are together, and that's how we operated. I don't see any difference between us now. There's a bit of an accent between Takao and the rest of us, maybe, but he thinks exactly like we do. He's in the same mold as any other astronaut on this crew, and that's the key to what we were able to accomplish. The food was varied. The Russian food in the cans we'll leave for them to eat. We tried it, and I would certainly prefer Takao's space Nagima to anything that the Russian food offered us. And that's a wonderful part of experimenting with different cultures and traveling to different countries, is seeing that. But as far as this crew is, we are all the same color. And it was just, that's why we had a wonderful flight.
All right, let's go back here in the back.
Hi, Greg Pallone with Central Florida News 13. This is the 25th trip to the International Space Station. There didn't appear to be a lot of pomp and circumstance surrounding that. Is that something that each of you had spoken to each other about and said, hey, let's maybe toast to that? Any thoughts?
Well, I think this flight was interesting. We had a lot of interesting numbers associated, you know, STS-123, the 25th mission to the space station. I recall us doing a robotic op and all the decimal .8s on six different joints. I don't know the odds of that. We just, other than that, other than the coincidence of the numbers, we're all just another mission in the assembly sequence, and I don't think we put any significance at all on the 25th mission, other than it was interesting that we had so many coincidental numbers.
Yes, right here in front.
I am Etsuko Nagayama from Mainichi Newspapers in Japan. Let me ask to Mr. Doi by Japanese. 日本の皆さんに日本語でぜひメッセージをいただきたいと思います。日本語で質問させてください。まず今こちらに戻られての率直なご感想、それから、まずご自宅に帰って何を最初にされたいか、それから日本に帰って何をされたいか教えてください。
はい、今宇宙から帰ってきて、非常に、満たされている気持ちです。非常に満足しています。で、私たち自身こうチーム一丸となって、一生懸命仕事をして、成果を得られたということで本当に良かったと思います。また、日本の皆さん、多くの方々から応援していただいたことに感謝しています。で、日本に、帰ってからまずは日本のミッションコントロールチームですね、筑波にある皆さんと会って、今回の経験いろいろ、反省したりする点もありますので、デブリーフィングと言いますか、ミーティングでいろいろ意見交換をしたいと思っています。また、母とか兄とか、友人と皆さんと会いたいと思っています。
Could you tell us the question and answer in English what it was?
Yeah, she asked me how I feel today after returning from space, and I answered I'm very happy that we accomplished all the mission objectives, and we did everything we could do in space. That was a great mission. Also, she asked me how what I wanted to do when I return to Japan. So I'd like to meet all the members in Tsukuba that they supported this mission in Tsukuba Mission Control Center. Also, I'd like to see my mother and brother and my friends.
All right, let's go to the back here, all the way to the back row.
Jake Neske with TV Asahi. This question's for Doi-san. I apologize to have you answer questions twice again, but you guys sort of touched on some of the crew camaraderie Is there any specific story that you can remember of all of you together that was either, you know, something funny that you shared or something challenging? And if you could also answer in Japanese as well, it'd be greatly appreciated.
Well, I think you saw that we are dining together in the space station one day. I think it was Dom's idea that everybody got together, and I prepared Japanese food and a special souvenir for the space station crew as well as the shuttle crew, and that was the chopsticks. And I just wanted to just give them, but they started using chopsticks in space, and it was a good surprise for me. And they are very good because no gravity. They don't miss anything to holding anything, so it was a good, happy moment in space.
Tarek?
In Japanese? あの一番やはりあの、まあ、クルー全員で楽しかった思い出は、スペースステーションで、みんなでディナーを食べた時です。でその時私は、まあ、日本食を用意して、行ったんですけども、また同時にですね、箸をみんなにそのプレゼントしようと思って用意していたんですね。ただその時は、まあ、みんなに配るだけで おそらく終わるだろうなと思ってたんだけど、みんながその全員がですね、その箸を使って、宇宙食を食べ始めたんですね。でみんなすごくうまくて、なんでかなと思ったんだけど、そしたらやっぱり、まあ、ゼログラビティ、重力がないので、そうつまみ損なって物が落ちないんですよね。だからこうみんなうまく食べれるんですね。それがやっぱり一番、楽しい、まあ、全員での楽しい思い出です。
Okay, Tarek, you had a follow up?
Thank you. Yes, this is Tarek Malik from Space.com and Space News. And my question would be for General Ihearts, if he's still on the line, just about how how he felt returning to gravity during the landing, and I guess how he's feeling now. Thank you.
Did you hear the question at the crew quarters?
Strange feeling. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay, thanks. It was a strange feeling coming back to gravity after such a long time. I was actually wondering how it would be for me. I had, of course, heard stories from previous long-duration crew members, and of course that was a new experience for me. I feel actually well. I think the readaptation is going as I was expecting. Of course there are a few problems due to the vestibular systems which are remaining for a couple of days, but I'm pretty happy of how things are going, and I'm able to walk normally if I don't move my head too much. So yeah, adaptation is going well.
Any other questions out here? We can take one or two more if there are any. All right, well, in that event, then we're going to wrap up, let the crew go back to Houston, and that will conclude our briefing. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We mentioned we were a night launch. We launched at about 2:30 in the morning in Florida. The shuttle is just gorgeous with the lights lit up around it. About 4 hours prior, we're in the suiting room putting on helmets and gloves and boots and doing pressure checks. There's Box. Garrett's getting ready. He's a pretty serious guy. Hiding behind the visor there is Bob, finishing up his pressure checks. Takao is quite relaxed and ready to go. Our resident veterinarian, Rick, and he had plenty of animals to take care of on this flight. Here's Mike, our flight engineer, and there's Endeavor waiting for us, starting to vent and make some noise. We walk down the hallway in crew quarters and go down this elevator, heading out to this crew transport vehicle. It's like a motorhome that takes you out to the launch pad, walking like ducks with diapers on and everything underneath there. Again, Endeavor's waiting for us, and we're going to let the video audio go here.
Okay, Dom, vehicle's in great shape. The weather is go. In fact, it should be an interesting flight for you to punch through the clouds tonight. So on behalf of the KSC launch team, I'd like to wish you good luck, Godspeed, and we'll see you back here in 16 days.
Well, Mike, you just made people smile around the world, and you've got seven smiling faces on board here. water from over there. Start. 3 to 100. 102, 102, auto. Here, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. Clear away.
Houston Endeavor, roll program.
Don't be late, left. Clear away.
Unbelievable. What you're seeing here and what you're seeing here are some of the camera views that are mounted on the solid rocket boosters and on the external tank itself. This is from one solid rocket booster looking to the other. Absolutely unbelievable. In just a moment, you'll see Dom's initial maneuvering, and this is taken from a camera on the external tank, as he's maneuvering from the external tank during ET separation. Just a few minutes after main engine cutoff, we saw a sunrise, and then we start doing a series of burns. Here's Garrett and Rick feeling the acceleration of the orbital maneuvering system. This is the flight day 2 inspection of our thermal protection system, the tiles and the reinforced carbon-carbon. And then the third day is rendezvous day.
So it's a Friday 3, time for rendezvous with the space station. Now we are approaching the space station from below. And we are doing a special maneuver called the Alba Pichi maneuver, or backflip. So during this maneuver, the space station crew is taking pictures of the shuttle tiles to make sure that we don't have any damage. So during this maneuver, the space station is rising over the Pearl Bay. It's a spectacular view. Now we are going into the last section of the rendezvous, and the Dom is flying the space shuttle very slowly to the station. This is a view from the centerline camera. The speed is about 0.1 foot per second. We are going to make a contact, and we got a very successful rendezvous. We are happy campers making a high five.
Endeavor 11.
Oh, thank you. That's the sweetest call I've ever heard. Thank you very much.
So we got the hatches open, and we started coming on board. We thought Peggy was just happy to see Garrett, but actually she was demonstrating her pile driver maneuver. We brought some gifts aboard for Peggy, some candy, some clothing, some jewelry. There were hugs all around.
One of the things that happens on these really busy missions is right after docking, you get a quick briefing and have to get to work. Here is Box and I as we get ready to pull the platform that Dexter lived on until it was constructed and moved over to the space station. So we've headed through the hatch and got everything set up and pressed right into our robotics activities. And here Box is accomplishing the final maneuver, driving this boat of an SLP over onto the POA.
Okay, Garrett and I are getting ready for the EVA the first night with our pre-breather. We're in our magic masks. That morning, I'm first out, get out, see the cameras, and I can actually see the guys, wave at them a bit. Our first up is to get down to the JLP and get the CBM covers off to allow the module to be put on the top of station and pressurized. And you can see Garrett here is in the process of disconnecting some power leads to the JLP. Did a great job there, and this is his first EVA, and he's a pro. After that, Dom, Takao were moving the JLP up. We're out in the SLP working on Mr. Dexter. We talked about giving him his hands, pulling our tools out. You can see down low in the right there as all the robotics action is going on. And then later, myself here on the arm with Garrett here taking some pictures. And then we're removing the OTCM and putting that in place on the arm, getting ready for the EVAs the next day with Mike. And I'll turn this over to robotics.
This is an exciting moment for Japan. We are using the Space Shuttle Robotic Arm to move the Japanese Space Station Module Kibo, or JLP, to Node 2. And we are getting closer to attach it. And on Friday 5.
This is a small step for one Japanese astronaut, but a giant entrance for Japan to a greater and your space program.
I love Neil Armstrong very much. And once we open the hatch, we are working hard inside. Also, we are playing hard. I had a chance to throw a boomerang. It flew very well.
On flight day 6, Rick and I went outside for EVA 2, and our primary task that day was to attach the arms onto Mr. Dexter's body. So we had some free float tasks that we worked on initially. Here's Rick working with our pistol grip tool on a bolt there, and with a ratchet wrench here, making some attachments. And then here's Rick attaching the foot restraint to the arm so that he could be anchored in the arm and do some work from the arm. Next, we started to work together to get the first arm off of the pallet. We had a little trouble getting the connectors off there. Here's Rick using a pry bar, which we weren't planning to use. This is a normal way to use a pry bar. We finally got that bolt out. And then here's another use for a pry bar. We got this second, we call them expandable diameter fasteners. He got that arm off. Here he is pulling it out. And we're going to temporarily stow this one. He was giving me some hand signals. We're going to temporarily stow this one on the side of the SLP. And then we'll go to work on the second one. The second arm, Rick is pulling the second arm out with the help of the robotics guys, box inside, driving him around. He hands that arm off to me. You can also see on this D-handle real quickly some bandaging because it had some damage on it we had to repair. While I'm holding that arm, Rick is pulling the body up, rotating it up out of the pallet so that we can attach the arms. Another good job by the robotics guys inside. Here's Rick attaching one of the arms, putting that fastener in there. And this is what the Dexter looked like after we got the arms on.
Well, in between EVAs 1 and 2, or 2 and 3, we had a little bit of a break. So this is some video taken inside the stack. We got everybody to eventually show us a dive. I think some of the best dives were done by the veterans like Rick. All right, to Cal, he's giving us a half gainer. There's Garrett. And finally, the winning dive by Dom.
This is the beginning of EVA 3, finishing up construction of the SPDM Dexter, I guess. And you can see one of the components that I've just passed off to Rick there. And we later attach those both onto Dexter. After this comes one of the first of many opportunities I had to look at myself in a mirror, I guess. That's what they're accusing me of while Rick pounded on me. This is Rick actually having an opportunity to take some closeout photos of the SPDM after we've completed the construction. Here's another opportunity for me to look at myself in a mirror as I climb across on the SLP platform. And while I was doing that, Rick started transferring some hardware from the shuttle over to the space station.
A good look of the RoboGeeks here as they're working inside. They've got me on the end of the swatter, so to speak, so I had to be nice. They're bringing me into the payload bay now so I can start the ORU, the Orbital Replacement Unit changeouts. I started with the yaw joint, which is a yaw joint on a large piece of metal that's a spare in case it's needed for the arm. And then we started with some electronics boxes, DCSUs, move those from the payload bay to the ESP or storage platform on the station. There's a nice picture of Bob up there on Columbus now, and you can see me flying right by him as he's working on the missies. I got some great shots of him. And it was a great day, and we're finishing up with Peggy in the airlock.
Here's a view of the completed Dexter before we attached it to the lab. Did a great job putting it together by the guys outside. We're halfway through, so it was time to celebrate over in the Russian segment. We had a multinational meal with Japanese and Russian food. Go with Japanese if you get a choice. A view of the mid-deck where we're exercising and keeping things not too cluttered. There's a lot of things stowed behind a net. Your kitchen table is wherever you want to make it. Guys are upside down floating and eating, and it's really enjoyable to do that. We ate almost all our dinners together and most of our lunches, and we had a great time together eating or working. A couple Caltech grads
together celebrating that fact, and that was marking our halfway point.
Flight day 9, we did EVA 4. Here's Bob coming out of the hatch for that EVA. Primary task was the tile repair, but we had some work that we did initially. Bob went and swapped out an RPCM, and I worked on an electrical connector here that proved to be a little testy. We got to work. We set up our tile repair sample kit. We started to flow this goo that we call it, STA-54. We tamped it down into all these samples, closed up the kit, and then played follow the leader, brachiating down the lab into the payload bay where Bob very gingerly stowed the sample box into this stowage bin here. We had some cleanup tasks afterwards, so we kind of broke off and went our separate ways here. Here's me pulling off one of the socks on one of the hands of Dexter, and Bob got a chance to work on that connector that was not proving to come off for us. And then Bob didn't want to pass up one more opportunity to look in a mirror. So we finished up EVA-4, headed back inside.
So inside here, I'm giving a little bit of description about what I was doing in that mirror, I guess. And as we had a little bit of a break before pressing on into EVA-5, you can see Mike and I suiting up again for the fifth and final EVA. Mike's got the hatch open here, and one of the great opportunities to go out in a daylight pass and see the Earth right away before I come out behind him, and he helps me get some tools on myself before we head up to start putting in the system that would provide power to the OBSS, the sensor boom that was going to be left behind on the space station. Garrett and Box really helped us out a lot, making it go smoothly with passing off that boom to us when we were ready for it. You can see Mike and I working into positions both at the top of the truss, the top of the world, so to speak. And luckily, you can see that red light come on up there in the top, and there was at least much rejoicing on board the space station at that point. You can see after we've gotten it powered, we kind of had to feed the cable out during the robotics maneuver, and you can see the boom moving there as I feed that cable out. So Box was really patient with me as I fed that cable out. You can see the boom is almost in final position, and Box has passed it off to Mike and I and backed away, and we'll see Mike accomplish the final attach point of that boom to the space station, where it's now living and waiting for the 124 crew to come up and use it. After that, we pressed on to some additional tasks. Mike got to go over and work on one of the solar array joints, while I went over and worked on the recalcitrant MISSI experiment with a hammer and got that installed before we pressed back into the airlock and completed the fifth and final EVA.
Our mission is drawing to close, and we are leaving our mission patch on board the space station. And it's our farewell to the space station. And Garrett wanted to come back with us, but Peggy grabbed him back. He's a lucky guy. We had a wonderful 12 days on board the space station. The space station is just a giant toy box. It's a great place to play and work. And we miss the space station a lot.
Well, this is bad shirt day. Dom asked, what do you want to wear on undock day? And I said I wanted to look like that tropical plant. But this is a very exciting time for a pilot where Dom has the bravery to let me take the controls for a little while and basically undo what he did about 12 days prior. We back away to about 600 feet. And the whole maneuver, backing away to 600 feet and then flying 360 degrees all the way around the space station, it takes about an hour and a half. So we actually experience a sunrise and a sunset during that period of time. So you'll see both daylight and nighttime views of the space station. This is a breathtaking view of the backdrop of the Earth below. And then at night, we're starting to get further away after a separation burn, ready for the next couple days for reentry. This is the payload bay doors closing just hours prior to landing, and we spent the next couple hours getting our suits on and
converting the space shuttle, as Mike said, to a glider.
Endeavour Houston, you're on energy approaching the hack. No changes to winds or weather. Nominal chute deploy.
That's the view looking out the heads-up display at night.
I see the runway. Houston Endeavour, field in sight.
Glad somebody sees it. But the imagery from the ground is just thermal imagery. And here's approaching the runway at about 50 feet.
Down.
5225, 10. Box put out that parachute, we stopped. And within about 45 minutes, we're outside, smiles on our face, looking at each other, helping each other stand up so we wouldn't fall over. But that is one happy, satisfied crew with a great, great mission behind us.